Hi, my name is Sigmund Yevuga, Managing Consultant of Aspire Professional Consult. I bring you another video on the IFRS series we've been airing for various students partaking in the, or who will be writing the ICA exams for financial reporting and corporate reporting for their professional qualification exams. And today our session is focused on IAS 16, specifically property, plant, and equipment. And I want you to come with me, because for this standard, we shall be looking at the definition of what is a property, plant, and equipment according to this particular standard. We shall be looking at the recognition of various items for this particular standard. We shall look at the initial measurement of a property, plant, and equipment. We'll also look at depreciation, initial measurement, subsequent measurement, as well as issues of subsequent expenditure. So if you can come with me, we can look at definition of a property, plant, and equipment. And what is a property, plant, and equipment? According to IAS 16, a property, plant, and equipment are tangible assets that are used for the following. That's number one, for production and supply of goods and services. Number two, for rental to others, or for administrative purpose. And you must know that for this particular property, plant, and equipment, these are assets which are expected to use for more than one accounting period. So clearly, from the definition, it is in two aspects, clearly telling you what the use is and the duration for which this asset will be held for. So we can look at recognition. For recognition, because a property, plant, and equipment is an asset, the recognition principle says that for a property, plant, and equipment to be recognized, it should be probable that the economic benefit associated with this item will flow to the entity. And number two, the cost should be reliably measured. Now, we can look at the other issue, that is the initial measurement of a PPE. For PPE to be initially measured, or the initial cost to be placed in the financial statement, we should look at the various elements of this initial cost. The cost comprises, number one, the element, that's the purchase price at which the asset was acquired, less discount, and you add all non-refundable taxes to it. Then you look at all directly attributable costs of bringing this asset to its intended use. Then subsequent to that, you can also look at the initial estimate of all the costs you shall incur in dismantling and removing this asset from the site on which it is located. Some call it restoration cost, some call it dismantling cost. The names are several. So here we should clearly know that when it comes to a PPE, the initial cost comprises three things: the purchase price, any directly attributable cost to bringing this asset to its intended use. Then the final cost is what the cost we incur to dismantle or remove the item and restore the site on which it is located. So basically that is it. But you should also be minded that when it comes to self-constructed asset, we may not necessarily have all this element of cost in there. Also for assets which are exchanged for another, we may also not have this element of cost being made up of it. So clearly that is it. For initial measurement of an asset, that is clearly recognized under property, plant, and equipment. The standard says that you should ensure that these three components of cost are captured: the purchase price, the cost which are directly incurred to bring it to its intended use or location for the purpose of using it, then the initial estimate of dismantling, removing the item, and restoring the site on which it is located. Then we can look at depreciation now. Once you have initially recognized this asset in your books by knowing the cost at which you shall recognize it, the next thing is to depreciate it. Depreciation is very important. So the guidance from the standard says that for depreciation, the depreciable amount should be allocated on a systematic basis over the asset's useful life. Very important. Then also the residual value of the useful life of the asset should be reviewed at least each financial year, because you see expectations may be significantly different from year to year. So based on that, you must review that. Then the depreciation method should reflect the pattern in which the asset's economic benefits are consumed by the entity. Also, we can say that depreciation should be charged to the financial statement, specifically the statement of profit or loss. Then depreciation should begin when the asset is available for use and continuous until the asset is derecognized, or when all the useful life or the economic benefit that we expect may not come to us as an entity. So that's what we call derecognition. So the asset has exhausted its useful life, or we don't expect any economic benefit to flow to us as an entity. So clearly that is it for depreciation. But we can also look at the methods of depreciation. Clearly, for most entities, there are two methods. And the methods here, we look at the straight line method as well as the reducing balance. And the guidance is therefore straight line. We consider the initial cost less the residual value. And then we divide or, what do you call it, divide by the useful economic life of the asset. Then for reducing balance, you multiply the percentage or the rate of depreciation by the carrying amount of the asset. So we can look at other issues which are very important, specifically subsequent measurement, very important. We consider it's very important, subsequent measurement. The standard allows that for subsequent measurement of PPE, we adopt two methods, whichever you choose, you can go for it. The first method you can choose is the cost model. The other method is called the revaluation model. For the cost model, what does this incorporate? It says that the PPE, that's the property, plant, and equipment, should be carried at the initial cost, which we have already discussed, saying that it comprises three costs, is that not it? The purchase price, the directly attributable, and the site restoration, then less any accumulated depreciation. So here it means that if you are adopting the cost model, you are going to keep your asset at the carrying amount or the net book value. And this means that the cost of the asset less any accumulated depreciation. But what you must not forget is that once you are using the cost model, you must incorporate what we call impairment. Impairment is a test usually carried out on an asset to know if the carrying amount at which is in the book is higher than the amount we can realize for it. So please clearly know that if you are using the cost model, it is very important that you consider the principles of impairment, because there will be times where the cost at which you are keeping the asset in the book, that is the net book value, may be higher than the amount for which you shall recover the asset, either by sale or continuous use. So clearly there's a guidance for that under IAS 38, a separate standard that deals with this. So you cannot use the cost model if you don't understand the principles of impairment loss. So it's so important. So this particular model runs with impairment loss captured under IAS 36. For revaluation model, which is a second method of subsequent measurement of PPE, this says that your PPE should be carried at a revalued amount. What does it mean? It means here that you must incorporate the fair value of the asset. Some will say the market value of the asset. So it means here that at every point in time, you must ensure that you check whether the asset's market value has risen, and therefore incorporate that fair value or the market value into the cost of the asset. So here you must keep the asset at the revalued amount, meaning that you must incorporate the market value. And this can only be applicable once you can be able to determine the fair value of the asset. And that guidance is provided for that under IFRS 13, fair value measurement. So please, clearly, these are the two methods for subsequent measurement of PPE. You either go for the cost model, where you keep the asset at the cost less depreciation, but don't forget, you must remember the principles of impairment loss and incorporate it. Or you go for the revaluation model, where you must keep the asset at the revalued amount, which means that you must incorporate the fair value of the asset at every point in time and then subsequently depreciate it accordingly. Then also, as I said, without the IFRS 13, you cannot determine the fair value of this asset. But you know, for these two models, both cost and revaluation model, the most difficult one is the revaluation model. So I'll just throw a little light on that and we move to other issues. So you can, for the revaluation model, further guidance here, you should know that the revaluation should be carried out regularly, so that the carrying amount of the asset should not be materially different from its fair value. Clearly, you must do that, because you see, at every point in time, the excess fair value may be going up. So you must do it as regularly as possible. It also depends on where you are using the asset. If you are using the asset in a particular environment where the fair value may not change from year to year, you can wait for a while before doing the incorporation of the fair value. Now, also, still on revaluation model, another further guidance is that if an item is revalued, you should ensure that the entire class of asset to which that asset belongs should also be revalued. So you don't choose. You don't just select and say, okay, because this particular asset has increased in fair value, you suspect such, then you can incorporate the fair value. Please, you should know that once that asset is forming part of an entire class of asset, you should ensure that you incorporate the fair value for all of them. You cannot do the revaluation for only one asset. You must ensure you do it for all the assets that belong to the class. Now, finally, the revalued asset should also be depreciated in the same way that we depreciate for the cost model. So don't forget that even though you are using the revalued method or revaluation model, where you are incorporating the fair value, the asset should be continuously depreciated until the next revaluation. So clearly that is it. But there are some very interesting issues when it comes to revaluation that students must ensure they obtain guidance on. How do you treat gain or loss on revaluation? Very important. How do you treat that? Then there's also another issue of excess depreciation. Please, you must obtain guidance on this. Then issues of disposal of assets. How do you treat the revaluation on an asset that has been disposed? In future, we shall take various questions which will espouse knowledge on all of these issues and you'll be properly guided. As we have said, these videos are just introspection or brief introspection into the IFRS or this particular standard. So there'll be clear questions that we shall take to espouse all these particular issues in respect of the revaluation model and also in the entire or for the entire IAS 16 in general. Then we can also look at the final discussion as we shut down IAS 16. And this final discussion is about subsequent expenditure. I'll run you through them and then we shut down on IAS 16 for now. So on what basis do you capitalize a subsequent expenditure? So you have an asset, you have incurred expenditure on it. It could be in the form of repairs, it could be in the form of improvement. But on what basis do you capitalize it? Meaning that you are incorporating that new expenditure you have incurred on that asset as part of the cost of the asset. Now, this is the guidance. If that cost that you have incurred will enhance or extend the economic benefit or benefit provided by that asset or the useful life of that asset, then on that basis, you can capitalize that expenditure. Then also, if it relates to an overhaul, in some circumstances, you may have to overhaul an asset, meaning that at a point in time, you have to remove a particular portion and replace it with another. Or there will be a requirement of major inspection of an asset. And this is mostly to do with various assets. I think most of the time with airlines, various aircrafts, and then as well as vessels in the maritime industry. They require major inspection. So at every point in time, once there's inspection, you may have to replace that component of the asset. And also for overhaul, you can also do same for complex assets like aircraft as well as vessels. So what we are saying is that once it relates to overhaul as well as requiring major inspection, please, it is also a basis for you to capitalize the subsequent expenditure in that regard. So clearly that is it. But for overhaul, what we normally do is that the cost is capitalized and depreciated to the next overhaul and also for the next safety inspection. Then we can go on to look at the last issue, which require capitalization, where it is required in replacing the component of a complex asset, we can also capitalize the subsequent expenditure. And as I said, a very good example of a complex asset is an aircraft. For an aircraft, the various components may have different useful life. The engine may have a different useful life, the fixtures and fittings in there. So clearly what happens is that various components of this particular asset have various useful life at which they may be de-recognized or replaced. So on that basis, what happens is that this asset, once there's a new expenditure incurred to replace a particular component, that component must be what? Must be also be depreciated or capitalized before depreciation, if you want to say that. So clearly, aside all these expenditures, any other expenditure incurred may be expensed, or we call them revenue expenditures. So on that basis, it is clear to say that once the expenditure we are incurring on the asset, that is a PPE, will number one, enhance the useful life of the asset or the economic benefit if it relates to an overhaul, and also if it is replacement of a component of a complex asset, we have the opportunity to capitalize it. But once it does not relate to any of these issues, it is clearly a revenue expenditure. So therefore, we shall expense it in the P&L. So clearly, that is it. In conclusion, I want to say here that all students must wait and expect for our next slice of presentation on IAS 16, where we shall go into full details and bring you various questions to explain some of the key principles we have just clearly discussed. So what I'll say is that you can look at all our videos. There are various videos on various standards, IAS 16, that we have just done. We have 40, all of them, all the various standards. The videos are here. You can look at them and watch them. So see you in our next video. Thank you. Thank you for watching another video from Aspire Professional Consult. For more of these videos and audio lectures, you can join our e-learning program by downloading our app on both Android and iOS. For those of you who want to join our classroom lecture, you can also join us on both weekends and weekday, either at Kwabinya for the weekends and Accra Central at the Hockey Stadium for the weekday. And also, we give you an opportunity to buy books from our published house, That's Aspire Publication by dialing the following numbers provided on your screen. Thank you, and see you in our next session.